PAXA, Hawaiian Financial Federal Credit Union, and HGEA present The Timmy Chang Show on ESPN Honolulu and KHI. Brought to you by IBEW Local 1186, Hawaii Pacific Health, Enjoy Snacks, Nonstop Travel, St. Louis School, and Hawaii USA Federal Credit Union.
Welcome to Ruby Tuesday, Moana Lua for the Timmy Chang Show, everybody. Thank you so much for being here. We really appreciate it. We're going to have a discussion with Coach Timmy Chang. Thank you so much, Coach, for being here. Appreciate it.
Yeah. Good to be back home on the island. Yeah. On this beautiful day and getting ready for a big game this week against New Mexico State.
Absolutely. We'll get into New Mexico State just so that everybody knows what the rundown looks like. We're going to talk Albany. Then we're going to get into Oregon. Then we'll be talking about the upcoming opponent against New Mexico State. We have a special guest, Coach Chris Brown, today. And so we'll be having a conversation with him. We might even ask him what size shirt he plans on wearing eventually. and then we'll be giving away some stuff during the break. So thank you so much for everybody being here. The number to dial in, if you've got a question for the coach, 808-296-1420 is the number to call or dial or text. And we will have answers for you. Coach has always said, ask and he'll answer as best he can, huh?
Yep. And if it doesn't give away information or, what's best for the team.
Perfect. Okay, great. Okay, let's go ahead and look back at Albany real quick. We'll get into Albany. Let's relive the win. It was a good matchup at home. The FCS opponent, after a negative 5 yards rushing performance against Stanford, Hawaii's run game returned against UAlbany. Five different ball carriers contributed to a 113-yard ground game. Tylan Hines with 30 yards on four carries. Najee Bryant Lalay, he made his first appearance this season by adding 35 yards on the ground, a couple of hard runs. He really looked happy to be back in the field, in fact. And then Jordan Johnson bursted out also in his first appearance this season. 11 carries for 76 yards, 6.9 average. The run game was back.
Yeah, it was a point of emphasis. I just saw Tylan run. We haven't had Tylan healthy in a little bit, and so, but Mojo was interested in training camp, and Jordan had a good response in the game. He was with us with training camp for a little bit, and so, it's good to see those guys back, gaining the offensive line some confidence in there and being able to run the ball, and getting it started.
You have a stable now of running backs that can perform.
Yeah, that's the key, right? Is trying to recruit depth. You know, at one point, it was very slim at the running back position, and that's why we moved Landon over. Landon, you know, had a big run and then got his AC joint dinged up a little bit since Stanford, but also losing Mojo during training camp. Tylan's been out since Stanford, and so kind of getting these guys back. We're kind of getting a little bit healthy inside that room. There's a good stable of running backs, and then more importantly, the O-line's gaining that confidence. Iliki Tanuvasa, our senior captain, holding it down in the middle, and then we got some guys that are figuring it out a little bit, and so I thought they played well. We'll talk about the Oregon game, but I thought the Oregon game they played their best game. And really they're starting to come along a little, you know, just as a developmental team should.
And I see a question about Oregon. We'll get into that in the second segment. What brought down the average of the run game was quarterback Braden Shager. He was sacked, unfortunately, five times in this one. And the Rainbow Warriors at the point were leading the country in sacks given up. He also threw three interceptions in this one. One for sure was not his fault, although regardless, that's the way it gets put in the stat line. Coach, is it your thought that the O-line struggled a little bit against UAlbany?
It's back and forth a little bit. In certain situations, certain plays, could we have played better? Probably. And then in other cases where, Shags could have thrown the ball and got the ball out of his hands in a couple of situations. And so, again, each play is a little bit different. Of course, you don't want to take as many sacks as you did.
Right.
But everything – everything kind of matters, right? And receivers running routes and running backs are being where they're supposed to be and helping out in protection. And so it just varies from play to play, and that's kind of where, you know, as an offense, as a group, we just kind of have to be a little bit better overall in execution and all, in every single group.
But coming out of this game, Braden Shager was the leading passer in the country for the second straight week. He was 23 of 40 passing, 266 yards, 4 touchdowns. He did have 3 interceptions and those 5 sacks that we were just talking about. But the highlights outweighed the lowlights in this one, in my opinion. Jonah Pinoke, in his first game back, caught a touchdown on his birthday. You see it there, 4 receptions, 47 yards. Jalen Wathall had a touchdown that we will be talking about a little bit later in the show. Stephen McBride, 7 snags for 72 yards and 2 touchdowns. No scores for Pafele Ashlock, but he added 74 yards receiving. The shoot and the run was working pretty good in this game.
Yeah, not bad. You know, again, you alluded to some of the things, the sacks and a couple of interceptions. And they're not a lot of Braden's fault. We threw a screen for an interception. We threw an RPO for an interception as well. And so I think when we overlook and we're trying to be perfect, we're trying to hold the standard, we kind of harp on the little things and the details on where those things, you know, pop up and where we can correct them. But I think they played well enough to win. By no means was that an easy opponent. I mean,
right.
I had a day off after Stanford and on that Saturday, and me and the family were watching Albany go against Marshall, and they took the lead
right
going into the half and
held them scoreless.
And exactly, it was 3-0, and it was a tight game, you know, until Marshall scored its go ahead touchdown and won 21-17. And so, you know, we knew we had our hands full, and you know, they came down early to win. They flew in and got in on that Tuesday, and that just kind of shows me that they were ready to win and come out there prepared, and they were. There were good athletes on that side of the ball, even though people would think it was an FCS school, but they had some talent.
It's and, a good football team.
It was a good football team. It was a good challenge.
Yeah, depending, it doesn't matter what FCS, FBS, that was a good football team and a really good test for Hawaii. Mm-hmm. And Hawaii came out with the win. So let's take a look back and see some of the highlights from Hawaii's win over UAlbany at home just 2 weeks ago. Actually, we'll get to that in just a second. But let me ask you this real quick. Is a win for you? I mean, it was a close victory. There's no moral victories. We talked about that. But real quick, the win felt good no matter what, right?
No doubt. When anytime you can win, it's just a better feeling. It's a better feeling in your group. It's one in your column. It's closer to your goals and what you're trying to do. But you'll take any type of win, regardless if it wasn't pretty or it wasn't good. Wins are wins, because you'd be on the other side of the thing and it wasn't pretty, wasn't good, or it could be as pretty as and good as you want and you lose. You know, it's the same thing. Yeah. It's a loss, right? And so. You take them, and then you go back to the drawing board, yep. And you come back into work Monday, and you get to it.
Each week is a new week, but let's take a look at the sights and sound of the win over UAlbany. He's running wild, still going, spinning off a defender and down to the 15-yard line. It is caught. Jonah Pinoke, touchdown, Hawaii. Looking left, fires deep left, McBride, touchdown, Hawaii. Hager firing to the right sideline, and this is caught. It's caught by Jalen Wathall, touchdown, Hawaii. Larkins, no, it's an option play, fumbled on the pitch, picked up by Hawaii. And that's Noah Kemba. He's running towards the end zone. Noah Kemba down at the 30-yard line. This is Hawaii's football. Throw to the end zone. McBride, touchdown, Hawaii. That feels good.
That was good. It was good. I mean, there are definitely some ups and downs in that game. And But to come out with a victory, I mean, it was a good overall team victory. And, you know, I thought the defense played really well, especially in some situations that we left them in with not getting some fourth downs down there. And they came and responded, and that's what you like to see. That was some good complementary football. Offense had to move the ball when it did, and scored when it did. And special teams came up big with a block punt, and that's what you want to see in your team.
Final score 31-20 over the Great Danes. All right, before a break, time now for random questions. If not football, Coach, what is another sport you like to watch?
Oh, that's a good one. Seasonal and yearly. Well, yearly, you know, there's good MMA fights. There's good boxing fights. Boxing's been pretty good. But, of course, you want to support the local brothers and sisters as they're fighting their MMA and living out their careers and dreams. And so love watching that. But also I'm a big basketball fan. And so,
really?
Yeah, big basketball fan.
Favorite team?
The Lakers. And
I
was a Duke fan. I was talking to Coach Ron, and you know, we were just talking about the Maui Invitational being here this year because of what happened at Lahaina.
Yeah, yeah.
And so we're talking about those things happening, and he was raising money for a game against St. Mary's, a charity game that he wanted to send to those to send to the victims and the people of Lahaina and the community of Maui. A lot of good dialogue, but college basketball has to be on top of one of my favorites to watch.
Good stuff. There's a random question. All right, when we come back, we're going to take our first time out. We're going to be headed to Oregon, a recap against the Ducks and what Hawaii learned from its trip to Eugene. This is the Timmy Chang Show. We'll be right back.
This is the Timmy Chang Show from Ruby Tuesday Moanalua, presented by ESPN Honolulu and K-Hi.
All right, welcome back to Ruby Tuesday Moanalua. The fearless leader, Rick Nakashima, not here today. It's okay. We were just talking about him during the break. I'm going to see him tomorrow. It's you can tell when he's not here.
I'm sorry I asked. Rick, I'm sorry I asked this guy.
But there is happy hour specials. Ask your server. Jong's walking around. Coming up a little bit later, we'll be talking to the linebacker coach. Still looks like he could be playing.
Yeah.
Chris Brown. We've got some questions. Let's start by telling everybody you can text in 808-296-1420. That's the number to text in. Go ahead and ask Coach some questions. We hear a lot of people talking after the games. We want to have some questions being asked. One here says, Coach, did Oregon show you anything different that surprised you or caught you off guard? Any comment of President Lasner's retirement? He's been a great supporter of UH Athletics.
Well, the Oregon question, you know, they were a good team. You know, elite athletes. When you know, as I came from Nevada, the last 5 years, we're recruiting a lot of West Coast athletes. We're recruiting up and down California, Arizona, Nevada, all these different places. And you know, we pull up guys, and really, you know, the first pick of the litter really goes to Oregon. You know, and so when guys pop on film and we're recruiting them as sophomores or juniors, you kind of know the kind of their players because of, you know, them committing early on and getting those type of guys. And so, you know, they schematically, they were, you know, they were sound on both sides of the ball. I think we really knew what they were going to do. It really came down to timely calls again and execution and just being consistent, which, you know, the score is going to tell you that we weren't.
All right, let's head to Eugene, Oregon. A tough one for the Rainbow Warrior football team as they face 13th-ranked Oregon at Autzen Stadium. This was a matchup, an opportunity, but a very good football team. From a 49-yard touchdown strike less than a minute into the game, it was a tough one to watch right into the end zone. And to a 22-yard run at the end of the first quarter, Jordan James added another score in the second quarter to make it 24-0. Braden Shager also threw an interception in the first half, his only one of the game that the Rainbow Warriors weren't able to cross midfield on offense in the first half. That was how tough is that for you to know that your team can get it done, but just wasn't getting it done at that point?
Yeah, I'm looking at that pick right now. I know he wish he could have that back
as high as and above him.
High and above man coverage. We have a shallow coming across. The guy's wide open, and he just sells it over his head. And you know it. I tell you what, as a player, and being in those guys' shoes before, you know, you can talk to them about these games, these big games, exciting games, these environments. But until you're really in it, you know, it's one thing to talk about it and be there and watch it on TV. But there's another thing when you're the guy catching the ball, and that's part of it, right? That's really part of it. And you know, as he grows into the offense, as he grows, as well as all the rest of the guys, right? It's everybody. It's me. It's everybody. And when you start to get into it and understand it and understand what it's going to be, you really just kind of peel back the layers. And that's why you like the guys being developed. You like the experience. You like them going through things like this. And so they know how to be moving forward. And that's what we're focused on right now.
What do you say to your quarterback when he walks off, and after he's done that?
I forget what I said. Probably wasn't nice at the time.
At the time, but now that you look at it, do you say sorry?
No.
No, sorry.
No, you know what? But we talked about this, right? Okay. Being in his situation, right? This is not the first time we've been to Oregon. I went to Oregon with Nevada, and we just beat Purdue the week before in a last minute 56-yard field goal. Brandon Tolton kicks one, and we take Carson Strong, 2-time Mountain West MVP, and we take him into Oregon, and we lost 70-7 or something. And so when we looked at this game in March on film and we broke them down and we talked about what we want to do, what we want to become, you know, this is the one team that we said, man, they're really talented. And maybe, we should, you know, I've lost over there by 70 as a coach. And really, we just kind of want to unload our bullets. And if we lose by 70, we lose by 70. But at least I'm not going to be holding back and regretting what we are. And so, you know, talking to Shags and talking to the offense, you know, it was there's a lot of motivation, a lot of you know, just understanding, you know, and I mean, people don't see it, but there's other guys that, you know, the first two plays of the game, you know, we know the call, we know what's going called. We made a mistake, yeah. you know, and just yeah. flat out busted it. And so it really becomes, you know, one of those things in your mind, like there's a mental thing going on with our guys, and yeah. we got to settle them down. We got to get them calmed down. We just got to realize, hey, it's like we're practicing on the grass field, or we're practicing in the Clarence Thiessen Chain Complex, and it's no different. Yeah, there might be 50,000 out here, but there really is no difference from football over there and football what we do every day.
Absolutely. Since you brought up mistakes, there is a question. I'll go ahead and ask it. It says, Coach, with the mental mistakes that the boys are making, could it be contributed to the lack of conditioning?
Yeah, I don't think so.
Do you make them run a lot?
No.
No? Do you pull from the school of June Jones where the receivers are running all practice long, that they get their conditioning in? I mean,
yeah.
We used to run 16 110s after like almost every practice, to the point of throwing up yeah. almost.
You know, there's a lot of money put into the science of sports now and trying to get an edge. You know, we do things at a high level here just because of the travel, the sleep patterns, those type of things.
Right.
And so wearing our guys down, you know, the biggest thing for us is that we're peaking on Saturdays. I would contribute a lot of the mistakes to, you know, to us having coached them. You know, it's really a player coach thing, right? You know, we coach the way we do, and if the message is not getting across, we got to find another way to do it. And then relying on our guys and putting our guys and trusting our guys to go out there and execute what we have game planned. And so those are all part of the things. But again, you know, for offense, I can say this, right? Our whole offense comes back next year, meaning that they're a young group.
Wow.
You know, the only guys, the two guys we lose are Solo Vaipulu, who's a true senior,
and
Iliki.
Yeah.
So the whole team comes back. And so, you know, when you got guys like Ashlock, I'll use Profele Ashlock as an example. You know, he's only played four games in his whole FBS career. The kid's a true freshman,
yeah.
19 years old, 18 years old. And we're relying on a guy like that. And there's a bunch of them in the room. We have a whole bunch of freshmen. But we, you know, we think that they're, you know, they're leading the country in some of these categories, or the top of the country in some of these categories. But, you know, they only played four games. And so there's going to be a development. There's going to be a process to this thing. And so sticking to the process and just kind of grinding through it and grinding through these things, you know, to me, I chalk up Oregon as, hey, that's an experience, man.
Yeah.
That's a big-time experience for these guys to go over there, play a top-ranked team in front of their fans, and learn from them. Learn from it, and it'll make them better.
Okay. Let's head back to Eugene, finish up some highlights. It was 34-3 at the half. In the second half, Tez Johnson added another TD, and Trayshawn Holden scored on a 60-yard pass. Running back Noah Whittington also scored, 227 yards rushing for the Ducks. Hawaii was down 55-3. Rainbow Warriors were able to get into the end zone late. Alex Perry scoring his first touchdown as a Rainbow Warrior this season. And Braden Shager finished the game 27-43 for 131 yards. That touchdown, he also had that early interception. He was sacked twice in the football game. Final score, 55-10. Final thoughts on Oregon.
Yeah, it was disappointing that we didn't get things going early on. You know, that interception you seen was in the second series. You know, in the first series you could point out things that didn't go our way and really just kind of hurt us. I thought the defense played well. The team moved the ball, but you know, the thing that I liked is that our defense didn't give it up easy. You know, they kept fighting. They made them go. They had to gain every inch and then every yard of the field. You know, there are times there were explosive plays where you saw that second play. He gets on top of our safety's head. You know, and that shouldn't happen, but it did. And but there's some positives in there, and you know, that's what we're gonna take away. And so for us, you know, in this four game stretch, we knew it wasn't gonna be easy. You know. We would like our record to be, you know, 3-1, you know, 4-0, 2-2, but it's 1-3 right now. And so, you know, this is meaningful football moving on from this point, and these are must wins.
All right, we're going to put the past behind us. Coming up after the break, we're going to take a look at what's next. That's New Mexico State. But first, more random questions. Coach, your favorite color?
Orange.
The Chang gang's cracking up over there. I was gonna see. I was waiting to hear if it was red or blue for St. Louis, and then if you said green, I'd be like, "What about the Crusaders?" If you said red or blue, I'd be like, "Ooh, what about the Bows?" Orange kind of throws a wrench in the whole thing.
I know.
And you're welcome for the orange lay.
I know. And these are beautiful lays that we get every week, and so thank you.
Yeah, thanks to Watanabe Floro and our good guy Bruce back there, and Chris Hart's big forehead in the camera right there. That's okay, Chris. No worries. So orange, any particular reason why? Do you like oranges, basketball? Well, you said you like basketball.
Yeah, I think I'm a warm weather guy, sun, the sun, you know. And
that doesn't help when you're going to Wyoming in November.
You don't tell Coach Bo that. You know, we embrace the competition and the time of year, and so, but you know what though, I do like orange. It's a warm color, and probably some of my kids over there like orange too because of me.
All right, we're gonna head to talk about New Mexico State after the quick break. This is the Timmy Chang Show.
This is the Timmy Chang Show from Ruby Tuesday Moanalua, presented by ESPN Honolulu and K-High.
All right, welcome back to Ruby Tuesday Moanalua. It's time now to talk about New Mexico State, but before we do that, I want to just let everybody know, if you got a question for Coach, he's more than willing to answer it. We've only got a couple here on our screen. 808-296-1420. You can text in your question if you don't feel like calling in. We are streaming live on Facebook and Twitter. And don't forget, you can catch the TV broadcast of this show tomorrow in case you want to watch it in its entirety on K-High. That's channel 1005. I know Coach Chris's family is going to be watching. You can catch Coach Chris on a former episode of Sam Choi's The Kitchen by going to K212.com, by the way. We're still trying to get into Coach Timmy's kitchen, but he's got to ask the Chang gang. All right, Coach, this says, Aloha, Coach Chang. We support you 100% and excited about the future of the program. Question on the offense. We haven't seen much crossing routes over the middle.
Yep.
Colorado State ran that play to perfection. This was a key play during the JJ, June Jones, tenure. Do we have those plays in our playbook? I've seen a bunch. I've seen mesh routes.
Yeah, mesh cross. I think what Colorado State at Jay Norvell, they ran a shallow to perfection because Torrey Horton, guy that I coached, was catching them. I think got like 16 balls against Colorado in that exciting primetime game. He, you know, we do have some shallows. In fact, the interception that he threw against Oregon was a shallow crossing route. There are some deeper shallow crossing routes. Ashlock caught one against Albany and took it down the field. Yep. Remember to spark the drive. So they're in there. It all depends what the quarterback read is. We're putting guys all over the field. We're trying to make them cover everywhere. But if there's guys in certain areas and there's certain reads and certain coverages and certain things that he'll throw the ball in different spots. And so hopefully we get some of those crossing routes like you talked about that you so fondly remember. Hopefully we get some of those in TC Chang.
Nice, nice. Okay, this week Hawaii will face New Mexico State. They come to town with two wins and two losses. A loss to UMass, a win against Western Illinois, then a loss to Liberty, but coming off of a win over Mountain West opponent New Mexico last week, who Hawaii will play on the schedule coming up. Your overall thoughts about the Aggies?
Yeah, good team. You know, last year was Coach Jerry Kill's first year. He did really well. You know, they had a good schedule. They had some wins that allowed them to go to a bowl game, end up winning the bowl game, I think, against Bowling Green. Very successful in his first year. So he looks back to return and run it back again. We get them at home, physical run game, different type of running schemes as they're going to try to spread the field, hit each gap, try to throw the ball vertical, and then defensively, a good defensive coordinator, you know, does some different things.
They run a little bit of the pistol, as we're seeing here on the screen.
Yeah. Just a little bit of everything. I mean, it's really a spread run game, and so they're just misdirection, using the quarterback's legs, running guys right, running guys left, behind, you know, and then play action and throwing the ball vertical and those type of things. And so definitely got a hands full. It was one of the games last year where on the road, I really felt that the team didn't play to what we thought we would play in the standard of Hawaii football, regardless of our situation. But, you know, we just got to play better football. And I think after this game, we had a bye week, and we responded in San Diego State, losing by that field goal. But this is a game that we circled that we want to play well.
Okay. They put up 450 yards total offense in their season opener, scored 58 points in one of their wins. And as you were saying, last year they reeled off 357 yards rushing only, just rushing, against Hawaii in an upset win at their place. We have a question here. How are you going to fix the O-line? Or there's 16 sacks, dozens of hurries. What can you do immediately? What UNLV and Sac State did this past week doesn't reflect well for our effort. I'm not sure exactly how that question, but the offensive line. I mean, we talked a little bit about that.
Yeah, again, a developing group that that you just want to gel. You want to, you got to give them time to get synchronized. I think I've been watching the New Mexico State film, and we got two guys in the National Football League on that offensive line, Il Manning and Michael Vanderpool.
Yeah.
And so you miss those guys, right? Those are veteran O-line guys, fifth-year, sixth-year guys that played really well at a high level. I'm watching highlights of and clips of them throughout the week is what we did against New Mexico State, and they're moving guys. And really, you got to give time to these guys to get better, and that's the reality of it, right? It's not going to happen. You know, Josh Atkins is a guy that's, you know, transferred in from Houston. We think the world of Josh, but this is Josh's first football that he's playing.
Yeah.
You know, this year, and Kaena is a walk-on from St. Louis High School, a local boy, a big brought out of Waianae, and again, these are guys that are going to take time. I mean, these are It's not an overall instant success that's going to happen. You got to take time in doing and getting them right and coaching them. And some of the time, the best learning is the failures. And so if we can just stay with the process and keep learning, keep getting better, I think we'll bowl well in the future.
We're just watching some Liberty highlights. This is more Liberty highlights with New Mexico State. Liberty has shown they at least exposed the passing game on New Mexico State's defense. They're susceptible.
Sure. Yeah. Without giving away too much, you know, I think we're just gonna have a balanced attack. You know, I think this team knows we throw the ball, and we've had a run game, and they seen our run game last year, and so, you know, I guess the chess game begins. You know, and we'll have to attack them the way we do, and different with our different formations and our guys. Lucky for us on offense, we're getting guys back and getting guys healthy, and so that's really good. And then defense, you know, they'll have their hands full on and stopping that run game.
We have a phone caller. I believe it's Don. Go ahead, Don. Okay, so it's a little bit hard to hear you, but I think what he's asking is when we're passing, the offensive line does one thing. When we're running, the offensive line clearly is doing something else. And are we too small on offensive line?
No, I think we're okay in some parts. I think when you compare us to three Power 5 teams, they might be a little bigger. But, you know, for what we do, we recruit guys that we feel that can do the job, especially for we're in the Mountain West in our conference, right? I think, you know, the Power Fives are set up for what they are, but you know it's all about. There's a lot of other factors that come into to play, and so
temper your expectations. I mean, this was a tough first quarter of the football season.
You know, I get it. You know, there's no one more passionate than me, and so. You know, I get the understanding of the question, but at the same time, I think you know the O line has to come in and develop. I think there's four new guys, three new guys that are playing in these spots, and it just takes time. You know, I looked at last year's O line. I said it in our offensive staff room today. I was like, we were kind of spoiled with what we had last year, but you know, the development of these guys are going to come along, you know, and they take pride in it. You know, Iliki takes pride in it, in his guys, and Coach Roman takes pride in his guys, and these guys are going to come. And Coach Roman's a hell of a coach, you know, again, but, you know, it just doesn't happen right now, and when we want it to happen, you know, I really feel that as the time goes on, they'll get better. And really just kind of remember these guys and see what happens to them and see how they pan out and if they become what we're talking about, what we want them to be.
All right, coming up next, Coach Chang and I are going to take a quick break. Again, we've got some text messages. We'll get to them in our fifth segment. But up next, my brother broadcast partner, Mark Veneri, is going to be joined by the Hulk. I was listening. I heard the Hulk, but it's Chris Brown. Coach Chris Brown coming up next with Mark Veneri, linebackers coach. This is the Timmy Chang Show.
This is the Timmy Chang Show from Ruby Tuesday Moanalua, presented by ESPN Honolulu and K-Hi.
All right, welcome back to the Timmy Chang Show here at Ruby Tuesday Moanalua. We've got Chalk Talk time with our good friend, my brother broadcast partner, Mark Veneri is joining us, as well as a very special guest, linebackers coach Chris Brown. Let's take a quick look at Chris Brown's journey. Okay, he was a linebacker for UH at the end of the Von Oppen era, at the beginning of the June Jones regime from 98 to 2002. So he has seen the best and worst of it all. He was a free agent and signed with the Baltimore Ravens and played a couple of years there. He started his coaching career at St. Louis School, then his alma mater, before enjoying a career at Nevada at Bishop Gorman High School as the assistant head coach and defensive coordinator. And now, my brother broadcast partner, Mark Veneri, with the linebacker, get it? Linebacker coach, Chris Brown.
Thanks, Johnny. I'm kind of intimidated next to this guy. Like, I'm normally intimidated all the time, but I mean,
but at least you're here because your brother John was afraid of me.
I do say this, Coach Chris, I don't know if you even see me on the field before the game, but I always come to the linebacker, the Lions den,
yes,
because I need to get pumped up before the broadcast with John. So I make sure right before the broadcast I'm right next to you.
Yeah, you got to give those boys that motivational speech. You know, sometimes I get in there and I got to control myself because I feel myself getting in there and want to tackle too. So. Yeah.
Well, Johnny mentioned it, of Von Oppen to Jones. You experienced it all. And talk about that journey.
Shoot. I mean, it was something in 1999, you know, to be a part of that whole big turnaround, you know, the greatest turnaround in NCAA history at the time. You know, going into triple overtime with Fresno State. Oh, my goodness. You know, I came from Damien, you know, love my Monarchs, you know, but we didn't win anything, you know. We didn't win anything, you know. So, actually, to win a championship, man, meant the world to me, you know what I mean. So, it was a real special time for us, and that's when everything started rolling for the University of Hawaii. It was that 99 year. You know, I'm glad to be a part of that thing.
Well, we got something special here today for you, and – Johnny and I have been talking about it. We got kind of a tail of the tape for you.
Okay.
And it's a kind of something special, and I don't know if we can get that that graphic going up. It's some of the records that Chris Brown has held at the University of Hawaii. You got the bench press. You got the squat. So let's take a look at this. We got the 40-yard dash, 4.69. That's faster than most people, faster than me.
And that's at 265 pounds now, right?
You hold the UH record for bench press, 500 pounds. Let's get a round of applause for that one.
Thank you.
500 pounds. Overall bench press at 600 pounds.
Yeah, well, that's total most I've ever done in my life, yes. 600.
That's a lot of weight. How does that feel?
It is. It's pretty heavy.
And then you also have the squat at 615 pounds.
Yeah.
So how do you even bring that? Now, you bring all of those records. You have all of that on the UH weight room. How do you bring that lively energy to this squad and really teach them the game and that linebacking core?
You know, just saying to these guys that it can be done. You know, I had this vision of wanting to be the absolute best, you know, and that's what I try to bring to the linebackers and to the defense. You know, it's that mentality of being great every single day. You know, you can't be satisfied with what you do, you know, on an everyday basis. You have to strive to be great. You know, that's why I came up with that whole Lions Den mentality. You know, if you're going to be a lion, you're different than a sheep, right? You want to be something different, right? Sheep kind of just follow their way through life. Lions take chances, right? And they strive to be great every single day. That's why they're the kings, you know? So I kind of put that mentality on the linebackers, you know, and I push that on them every single day. And there's nothing that they can say that can't be done, because I can look at them and say, I did this before. You guys can do it too. So, you know, when they hear it out of me, and actually sometimes I get in there and I actually bench press with them or work out with them, they say, okay, coach is for real.
Now, how do we get some of those shirts? Because I need a Lions Den shirt. I really need one of those. How can we get some of those shirts?
Defend Hawaii. Defend Hawaii. Yeah, they were cool. They were awesome enough to come up with, you know, a little design for them for our Lions Den. And what's cool is that the proceeds go back to the University of Hawaii, you know, so – it's kind of just to support everybody in general. But, you know, like I said, I love that mentality of just trying to be great, being the best version of yourself every single day, you know, and that's what the Lions Den mentality is all about.
And what's it been like for you to return home coach with your brother, Timmy Chang. You guys were teammates. But what's it been like for you to return home, coach in your hometown, and coach for the University of Hawaii?
You know, I had a good thing going up at, you know, up in Las Vegas. But two things came out of this. You know, I love the University of Hawaii with everything I got. And I feel like I owe the university something for what it's given me. You know, and the second thing is that I believe in what Coach Chang is doing. You know, I believe in his dream, his vision, you know, and I want that back at the University of Hawaii to be great again, but to do it the right way, you know, to do it built upon, you know, pride and love and, you know, the brotherhood, you know. And so, you know, with him taking the head, I said to myself, I'd love to be a part of this and, you know, be on his side.
Appreciate you, Coach Chris Brown, linebackers coach, the Lions Den. We'll be back with more on the Timmy Chang show after this break.
This is the Timmy Chang Show from Ruby Tuesday Moanalua, presented by ESPN Honolulu and K-High.
All right, final quarter here at Ruby Tuesday Moanalua. It's been great. We won't be here next week. We'll all be in Vegas, and then we'll be back the following week prior to the home game. So that'll be nice. But first, New Mexico State. I just want to go back real quick to something that actually made ESPN highlights. It was at the Albany game, and let's just look at it. It's one of the most crazy, unbelievable catches that I've seen in a long time at UH. It was Jalen Waffle with this one-handed catch. Not a great angle there, but take a look at this. Everybody's going to look at it. Coach, you can't teach stuff like that.
Yeah, some of their athleticism is starting to take
you
over.
Can't you can't teach this either, by the way, which thankfully he wasn't flagged for it. But that's awesome. Yeah. Right? Okay, maybe not for you, but for everybody else, it was really cool.
Yeah. You know, as they get more comfortable, you're going to start to see them make a little bit more plays. I think there's another great throw and catch of a back shoulder throw to McBride as well. But
he's been doing that a lot.
You know, there's some stuff that they're starting to pop up on film that and during practice that you're starting to get excited about, that you've seen the other ones, the other receivers and the other quarterbacks start to do.
Yeah.
So when they start to get comfortable, the thinking starts coming out. They're just going out there and they're just – then their God-given ability to just take over. Those plays start to happen.
All right, we've got a couple questions. Coach, after the game, when you speak to the opposing coach, win or lose, do you have a planned thing to say? Is it just like, hey, good game? Or do you just make it up as you run over to the opposing side? This is a legitimate question.
You know, I've had some really cool coaches to go and talk to during these preseason games. Jim Harbaugh last year, that was a good one. Dan Lanning, of course, is a good one. I've had the privilege of talking to some really good coaches before and after the game. It's not planned. You kind of just go with the flow of how the game went and just be really respectful. The Albany head coach wasn't there. He wasn't there for the last game. He was planning this trip for 8 years and wasn't able to come because of COVID. But he texted me after the game, and he said – and this was really nice because I know my guys wanted to go and score, but he was like, thank you for being classy and taking a knee and, not trying to run up the score. And that's what it's about. I mean, it's just – it's a respect factor before and after the game that really matters.
Quick plug for one of our sponsors. Hawaiian Financial Federal Credit Union is your one-stop community credit union for all your money needs. For life, open your account today. This is probably one of the best questions I've seen. Coach Chang, who is the better-looking Veneri brother?
That's my question.
Was it yours?
Oh, man. That's so bad.
Man.
That's so bad.
Don't answer it.
No, I won't.
He's good-looking.
They spit Veneri.
Mark's yelling, answer it. Jeez. Okay, go ahead. Tell him who it is.
You know who it is. There's no way. There is no way I'm answering that one.
All right, moving on. Next question. How well can Dalen Morris throw the ball? We saw him complete his first pass this past week. Any chance that he could be used more or he doesn't fit in with the run and shoot?
You know,
he does
a savvy guy to have on the field and in the locker room. Again, his story is unbelievable with him, being a full-time in service and also trying to get his degree to become a JAG. But he does a great job for us. He made a throw that I had to laugh at. we put him in that situation that, he throws with us every day. He does a good job. But we use him for his legs, and he did a great job, man. He's going to convert more short yardage situations for us, either goal line or third and short, fourth and short.
Okay. I think that's awesome. Jordan Johnson, 115 yards on 15 carries, got a 7.7 average. Hines, 18 of 63. Only run one rushing touchdown this year, 207 total yards in four games. It's starting to turn up, though, a little bit. Are you happy with where it's at? Are we going to see more of it?
No, we want to be better. I think there's got to be a growth mindset. We want to be better. We're going to be better. And it just comes with repetition. It comes with understanding, development. These guys working every day. The beauty about it is that, I got 17 guys yesterday working out at the Breakfast Club at 5 o'clock in the morning before practice. Another 24 this morning. It's an elite group of guys that just want to be better. It's not a mandatory thing, but it's a sign of a team that wants to get better, and that's what we want. We want these guys. Like Ashlock was there the both days, and he brings his roommates. He brings the other young receivers in. Guys are just being accountable, and they're developing. They're going to be better.
All right, it's time now to give away our Enjoy Snacks basket. Thanks to our good friends at Enjoy Snacks, who they are so nice to be able to come down here and give everybody something on their table. So. We'll mix it up. Go ahead, Coach.
No. Okay. Here it is.
Pauline Mitchell. Where are you at? Yeah, Pauline, the faithful fan who's at, like, every game. Pauline, there you go. Thank you so much for playing along. Again, we'll be back here, not this week or this coming Wednesday, but the following Wednesday. Coach, good luck at UNLV. They beat Vanderbilt this past week at home. I'm sure it'll be a tough task, but that's next week. New Mexico State this week. Good luck, Coach. Appreciate you being here, but, man, I hope you guys can pull it out.
Yeah, thanks, John. We got our work cut out for us, but these boys will fight.
Against the Aggies, and then conference starts. But first, let's go ahead and beat those Aggies. We hope that all of you are out there. We really appreciate you guys showing up to Ruby Tuesday. Moana Loa, Coach, better-looking Veneri brother?
No way.
No?
There's no way I'm answering that. I would never hear the end of it.
All right. We want to thank a whole bunch of people. Of course, Timmy Chang for coming out. Matt Chong, who didn't show up today, but he's always helping us out. To everybody on our Mahalo list, thank you so much for making this possible. Again, don't forget, you can watch the TV broadcast of the show tomorrow night on K-High. That's Thursday, in case you're watching on K-High right now, at 6 p.m. Go Bos, beat the Aggies. This is the Timmy Chang Show.